Today I'm going to venture into the topic of fear. And I do this with a level of hesitance because I don't want to come across as judgmental or as condescending or as giving a message of just get over it. There's nothing to fear. Don't worry about things. But we live, honestly, we live where fear is very, very prevalent among us. There's a new C word out there. It used to be cancer. Cancer was the word that would strike fear into people's lives. The thought of getting cancer. In today's world, there's a new C word that dominates our thoughts, dominates the headlines. We cannot escape it. And this C word has caused division, it's caused strife, it's caused criticism, both directions. It's caused anger, confusion. And this C word is a very political word, where politicians take stands on one side of another, almost to a line of a party line in how we treat this C word or how we deal with it. Opinions vary greatly, don't they? And we need to remember, they are opinions. This little bug that is so small has caused so many problems. And the problems are all greater because of fear. All of them. If you're among the cautious, I'm not sharing today to change the way you live life. That's not my goal. If you're living in fear, I do have some motives, some intent to encourage you to not fear. The word that is used over and over again that I hear in society is safe. We want to stay safe. Politicians want to keep us safe. There's a problem with that. The world that we live in is not safe. It's not safe at all. According to the CDC in 2017, now, if you know me, you know I'm a little bit of a numbers person. The numbers concerning deaths in Minnesota. In Minnesota, 2017, the most recent year I could find, there were 44,361 deaths in Minnesota. That comes to 3,696 a month average. Cancers that are related to cancer, there were 825 per month. Related to heart disease, 566 per month. Related to accidents, 131 a month, or about 4 people die a day from accidents. Now, when I take the deaths from COVID according to the CDC and I lump them all and say, just say for the sake of easy math, March to June, although my numbers actually go into July, quite a fair distance, there were 1,471 deaths at this point in time when I did the research, which comes to 370 a month. Really, it would be less than this, but we can see in simple math that that's about a 10% increase or 10% of the total, I should say, because I don't know if it's increase, 10% of the total deaths per month in the state of Minnesota. Now, we know that there's numbers of reasons for all of this, and there are factors. We know that 80% or 79% of these deaths happen in nursing homes and assisted living, so the elderly are at much greater risk. Similar, heart disease, some of us are more prone to this. Some of us are at higher risk. Some of us have had cancer in the family, so we are at a higher risk. Now, I'm not sharing these statistics or these numbers to minimize the risk of COVID. I'm just here to emphasize that we live in a world of risk, and we normally are not consumed by fear. I know every time I take my extension ladder out and I prop it up against the house to paint or to scrape or do whatever I'm going to do, that there is a level of risk that I'm assuming. but I live with that risk. I take those risks. The problem we live in today is that the media will not let us escape. Headline after headline after headline. I can't tell you how many headlines I have seen that have started with the words, experts say, comma, this could happen. All it does is instill within us a level of fear, a level of what if it happens to me? We are told to fear not. Fear not. In the King James Version, the words fear not, at least what I can find, I didn't count them myself, but I read that the words fear not show up 103 times in the King James Version. The thought of fear, which is often in the context of us fearing God, having a healthy, reverent respect of God, shows up over 500 times. Over and over again in Scripture, the thoughts of fear are introduced and talked about. Now, fear is God-given. It's considered that to have a healthy dose of fear protects us. So it's right. In fact, we teach children to fear certain things. A child needs to have a good understanding of electricity so that they don't put things in an electric receptacle. They need to fear it. Understand that it can harm them, and so they should keep their distance. Courage is not in the absence of fear, but rather it's in the presence of fear. That's what makes one courageous. So an individual who runs towards a fire and will actually enter into a building at personal risk is not doing so because he has no fear of getting harmed. Rather, he is doing so because something has risen in his mind to a level where the risk is not going to control him, where fear will not control. So I tell us over and over again, and I tell you over and over again, that we are to fear not, that we are not to fear. Last Sunday, Nancy and I decided to go for a drive. We were looking for a little bit of adventure, something to break up our day, break up our week, being isolated for the most part. We would do this on occasion, go for a drive, go to some quiet, distant place where there's nobody around. We decided to do some exploring and we were looking for county parks, believing that there would probably be just no one on a hot Sunday afternoon at a county park, relatively isolated. So we headed southwest and drove for a while, and we found one, and it wasn't quite what we were looking for, and there were some people around, so we drove on and we kept driving. We eventually came to a park that I don't even know if I could find again, but a little park that was well-groomed. The grass was green, it was mowed. There were some campsites there. The trees were beautiful, large oak trees. It was shaded. There was a driveway going in off the highway, and it wasn't large, and we could see the end of it. It just looped around, and so we drove around. And as we got towards the back, I looked and I focused as, hey, there may actually be something here that's worth checking out. And there at the back of this park were four tall poles, quite tall, two on each side, and steps, and it looked like, and it proved to be a bridge over a small creek. Actually, as we got closer, we could discern that this was a suspension bridge, that the boards going across this little creek were held up in the air by suspension of the cables that were connected at the top of these four poles. Well, this was exciting. It was a discovery, something that was like we'd driven quite a while to get there, and we've got to go check this out. And there was a little board walkway there, and there were steps. And we looked at this, and with excitement, we kind of climbed to the top of these steps. And then when we get there, and we could see the beauty of this little bridge and the trees and the water below, I realized that there were absolutely no safety precautions built into this. There was no handrails going up the steps. The steps weren't even built close together, but there were gaps between, you know, between the step where you could actually fall or slip and go through or twist an ankle. Looking across the bridge, there was a cable about 4 feet high that went across, and below that were some cables that connected to the boards that we were to walk across. But there was no guardrails. There were no little wires between that were connected it up so that if you would slip and fall, you wouldn't fall off. Now, it was about, I'm going to guess, 10 feet off the water, above the water, roughly. This bridge had no built-in protections. Now, I could imagine that had we had our grandchildren with us, we wouldn't let them near this bridge. However, kids would love it. And we'd allow them to play if there were some built-in protections, if there was rails on the sides, if the steps were built safely, when you walked across, you just couldn't fall off into the river. And now I found myself being ready to cross over, and I wanted to get to the other side. And everything looked solid. It felt solid. And we ventured across this little bridge, probably 20 feet across, and reached the other side. And I found myself as an adult a little bit nervous. My heart was a little bit racy, and I was a little bit cautious. Like, first of all, I questioned, is this bridge solid enough to hold me? And then as I started walking across, I was beginning to wonder, okay, am I stable enough to get across this? It's 5 or 6 feet wide, probably 6 feet wide across. I just pranced up the steps, gone down the sidewalk. I had no fear of stumbling and falling then. Why was I apprehensive as an adult to cross this bridge? When it was safe, it was solid, all I had to do was stay in the middle. I was apprehensive because I saw and I thought, what if? What if? What if I trip and fall and slip and roll and get hurt? What if? See, I really think that if I had to go across that bridge every day, maybe back and forth to work, maybe back and forth between the house and some other place where I went across it every day, I think I could get across it, and eventually I would cross that bridge and I would never think about danger. I would scoot right up the steps, go across and down the other side. But now I found myself feeling a little bit like Peter when Peter looked at the waves and he lost his courage. All because of fear. Fear entered, and it entered with the words, what if? I'm a little bit hesitant to say that I was afraid. That really makes me feel like I shouldn't be afraid of that. But the definition of the word afraid is to be fearful or apprehensive about an unwanted or uncertain situation. No question, unwanted and uncertain. Now, for me initially, this bridge, I was uncertain about its stability. I definitely did not want to fall. I definitely did not want to be taken to a hospital for, you know, a broken leg from falling down steps. So the uncertainty, though, was tied to initially the bridge, and then the uncertainty moved to myself. Am I stable? Will I lose my balance in the midst of this fear that came upon me quite suddenly? in Psalm chapter 46, the psalmist says, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. So we will not fear when earthquakes come and the mountains crumble into the sea. Let the oceans roar and foam. Let the mountains tremble as the waters surge. God is our refuge. God is our strength. It's as if the psalmist is saying here, let it come. God is my refuge. I am not afraid. Let the mountains roar. Let them crumble. Let the ocean roar. Let them try to intimidate me. I will not fear. God is my refuge. Overcoming fear has everything to do with confidence. I eventually put confidence in the boards so I could walk across. I eventually put confidence in myself saying, I can do this. This is ridiculous. It's 6 foot wide. I can walk straight 20 feet without stumbling and falling. Confidence. Ultimately, we must ask ourselves when there are things around us that are fearful, that are intimidating, that can bring harm, is do I have confidence in God? Is God my refuge? At this little park, there was a shelter. Now, the ability of this shelter to protect me should it start raining has nothing to do with my level of confidence in that shelter, does it? No, it has everything to do with whether or not I decide to stand out in the rain and get wet or go under the shelter. God is not limited by our unbelief. May I say this again? God's not limited by our unbelief. If that were the case, then God would not be God. But rather, the limitation may affect us. It may keep me from going to the shelter, from trusting in the shelter. But the strength of the shelter, the ability of the shelter is there. God is our refuge. God is our strength. God is a very present help in time of trouble. The word refuge or shelter is that which offers protection and offers covering, but is not insistent that I take that shelter, that I take that covering. God is our strength. The strength is strength to draw on when things are hard. That God is there to give us strength. Over and over in Scripture, we see how the Israelites went into battle. And in going into battle, how God was with them and God fought for them. But God always required something of them. They had to face the enemy. Many times God threw the enemy into confusion, sometimes caused them to fight each other. But God didn't say, well, you just stay here where it's safe in the camp, and I'll go out there and I'll take care of the enemy for you. God is our refuge. God is our strength to draw on when things are hard, when things are dangerous, when there are risks, when it can be intimidating. The question is, do we draw on this? And the psalmist said that God is present to help. Always. He is always present to help. All questions about God ultimately lead to a personal level and a personal decision. For I cannot make the decision for you to trust God. Christianity is a religion, is a faith that requires us individually to put trust in Jesus Christ. There are no grandchildren in heaven. Sorry, grandparents. I'm hoping I'm not disappointing you greatly, but there are no grandchildren in heaven. There will be none. For either we are a child of God or we're not a child of God. Each of us must come to Christ individually. And so it is for seeking refuge from God that in our lives, most of the time, when it comes to fear, each one of us must come to the Lord individually. I cannot come for you. We must enter through faith. We stay in a position of faith. We find shelter by faith. But we do this individually. The Apostle John, in the book of 1 John, speaks about this relationship with Christ and the connection to fear. He says, all who declare that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them, and they live in God. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in his love. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with confidence because we live like Jesus in this world. Such love has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. This relationship that God desires to have with us is initiated by his love for us. And as our love for him grows, there is no room for fear. Rather, the stronger my love for God, the less fear I will have in my life, because perfect love casts out fear. So we ask ourselves these questions. I may ask you this question. Have you declared that Jesus is the Son of God? Basically, have you asked Christ into your life? Have you experienced his forgiveness? Then I ask, how much does God love you? We say, well, God loves me perfectly. Of course he does. We know that. So we go to the next question is, do you trust his love? Do you trust it? And do you find that your love for Christ is growing? And if all of these things line up, then we must ask ourselves the question, okay, where does fear come from? Why at times in my life am I apprehensive about that which is uncertain, that which I can't control, that which could bring harm into my life? And it causes me to flutter and causes me to step back and to hesitate to do that which God wants me to do, or to do life as I would normally do life. Where does this come from? Paul stated in Ephesians chapter 6, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. I contend that fear is in the arsenal of tools, arsenal of weapons that Satan uses against us. That he throws things to intimidate us, to cause us to fear, to cause us to step back, to cause us to act in a way that we would not otherwise act. He desires to use fear to take away our joy, to take away our effectiveness, to cause us to not act when we should. He uses fear to cause us to make bad decisions, decisions that we would not make otherwise. Now, COVID-19 is real. I am not declaring this to be anything but real. It causes harm. It is something to be respected. For some people, it can be very, very significant. And we should give it the due concern that is there. But fear, likewise, is a real concern. That fear comes to us not from God, but it comes to us from the enemy. Now, it is easy for us, and I found this to be somewhat true in my experience just recently, but it's easy for us to not have fear, to be really confident when the war is being fought overseas. But when it comes close, our eyes get bigger and we step back, and then this question comes to our mind. Okay, what if? What if? And if we allow it, this can cause fear into our lives that once again would cause us to do things that we would not normally do. It would stop us from walking across a bridge that's wide enough and safe enough. Fear. That's what fear does to us. In the 13th chapter of 1 Samuel, we read an account of King Saul who gave way to fear, and the consequences were not good. Saul was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 42 years. Saul selected 3,000 special troops from the army of Israel, and he sent the rest of the men home. He took 2,000 of the chosen men with him to Michmash and the hill country of Bethel. The other 1,000 went with Saul's son Jonathan to Gibeah in the land of Benjamin. Soon after this, Jonathan attacked and defeated the garrison of Philistines at Geba. The news spread quickly among the Philistines. So Saul blew the ram's horn throughout the land, saying, "Hebrews, hear this, rise up and revolt." All Israel heard the news that Saul had destroyed the Philistine garrison at Geba, and that the Philistines now hated the Israelites more than ever. So the entire Israelite army was summoned to join Saul at Gilgal. The Philistines mustered a mighty army of 3,000 chariots, 6,000 charioteers, and as many warriors as the grains of sand on the seashore. They camped at Michmash east of Beth-Aven. The men of Israel saw what a tight spot they were in, and because they were hard-pressed by the enemy, they tried to hide in caves, thickets, rocks, holes, and cisterns. Some of them crossed the Jordan River and escaped into the land of Gad and Gilead. Meanwhile, Saul stayed at Gilgal, and his men were trembling with fear. Saul waited there 7 days for Samuel, as Samuel had instructed him earlier, but Samuel didn't come. Saul realized that his troops were rapidly slipping away, so he demanded, "Bring me the burnt offering and the peace offerings." And Saul sacrificed the burnt offering himself. Just as Saul was finishing with the burnt offering, Samuel arrived. Saul went out to meet him and welcomed him. But Samuel said, "What is this you have done?" Saul replied, "I saw my men scattering from me, and you didn't arrive when you said you would. And the Philistines are at Michmash, ready for battle." So I said, "The Philistines are ready to march against us at Gilgal, and I haven't even asked for the Lord's help." So I felt compelled to offer the burnt offering myself before you came. "How foolish," Samuel exclaimed. "You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. Had you kept it, the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now your kingdom must end, for the Lord has sought out a man after his own heart. The Lord has already appointed him to be the leader of his people because you have not kept the Lord's command." Saul was God's man. He was chosen by God to lead the people of Israel. Now Samuel was the unchallenged messenger for God. He was the prophet. He was the one who led in sacrifices. He was the one who went directly to God. This was not a role for Saul to take. And yet Saul did just that. In the midst of this time, Saul split his army. One-third went with his son, Jonathan, and two-thirds stayed with him. Jonathan is the one that took his army of 1,000, and they went and they attacked a certain site that had been Israel's, and they won. And the Philistines, the army of the Philistines, they were ticked. They were upset. They were angry, and they were going to put out an all-forces assault against Saul and against the armies of God. And Saul gave in to fear. War was imminent. It was there. It was going to happen. And they were outnumbered. Saul knew he needed God, but he was told to wait until Samuel came. When Samuel arrived and asked Saul his reasoning, his thinking, What were you doing? Why did you do this? Why did you offer this sacrifice when you knew that was not your job? Saul stated, I saw my men scatter. What he's really saying here is, I was losing control. He said, you didn't come as you said you would come. He says here now, really, I felt alone. Saul said, the enemy, they were prepared. The enemy was prepared to do battle against us. They were lined up. What he's really saying is, I felt threatened. And then he expressed his feelings and saying, I felt compelled. But what he really was stating was, I felt I had no choice. Was Saul losing control? Were his men leaving? Yes. Did he feel alone or abandoned? Samuel didn't show as quickly as he thought he would should come. Yes. Did he feel threatened? Was the enemy real? Were they all lined up? No question, yes. Was Saul in a position where he had no choice? No. Saul was not in that. All of this happened because Saul gave in to fear. He allowed fear to dominate his thinking, to push him into a corner where he believed the lie, I had no choice. I had no choice. When that is never the case for a Christian. I don't believe that's ever the case for any of us. There is always a choice. And this choice that Saul made cost him his kingdom. He would no longer continue to be king, nor would his family follow in his steps. The cost was very high. All because he listened to the enemy who caused him to fear. See, the issue is not the enemy. What Saul feared, the Philistine army that was all set up to attack him, they were not the real issue. If it wasn't this group of Philistines, it would be another group. It'd be an enemy from another and from another border. There would always be an enemy there to intimidate and to threaten to take that which belonged to Saul. The issue wasn't the Philistines. Likewise for us, the issue is not COVID. If it's not COVID, there will be something else. We know how it works in the news cycle. As soon as this is expanded and is used as fully as it can and dropped or becomes a non-issue in society, there will be something else that will come to the forefront of our newspapers, the headlines that will be there to cause us to fear. The real issue is our focus. Is our focus on God? Is our focus on God and who he says he is? Is God our refuge and our strength, our very present help in time of trouble? Is that where our eyes are in the midst of COVID, in the midst of cancer, in the midst of financial risk and loss and threats, in the midst of whatever enemy that comes against us, where's our focus? Will we decide to keep our eyes upon Jesus, who is always there for us? We're in his hands. We are in the hands of God. And it's a good place to be. Do not fear. I encourage you, do not fear, but rather choose to put your eyes, to keep your eyes upon Jesus. And he will give you peace, regardless of what goes on around us. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you for your presence. I thank you for what you offer to us in this shelter in time of storm, that we can run to this shelter and find you and find peace. Lord, help us to trust in you for all of life, for all of our family, for our health, for our finances. Help us to keep our eyes upon Jesus. Pray this in that precious name. Amen.